this time of worship and as we join together in fellowship at the Lord's table. It's a dull and wet Sunday morning, but it's warm and comfortable, and we've lots of fellowship here in this church as we worship. Our minister Mark is in Ballycarry taking their service this morning, which is probably his last Sunday service with them as vacancy convener. Their new minister will be installed at the end of the week, and we wish the congregation and their minister and family all the best. We are delighted to welcome back the Reverend Dr. Michael Barry. You're very welcome. We're always very pleased to see Michael. His family, of course, have a history here in our congregation. The surname Barry appears many times. So welcome and thank you for being with us. The monthly calendar you probably have got, but if you haven't, make sure you get one. It's in the vestibule. I've been asked to announce that on Friday, the 15th of November, there's an autumn leaves supper in the community centre, and the tickets for that are £20 and are available from Hazel Robinson. There's a few of our Word for Today booklets still available in the vestibule, and the other thing that has come through is a letter from our moderator. There are copies in the vestibule. Now please do take one, because this is our moderator calling us all to join in prayer for the Middle East, and there's topics for prayer, and as we join together it will give us something that we feel we can do, and it's the most important thing, and that is prayer for those in such terrible need. That's the announcements. Over to you, Michael.
How can I repay the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of his people. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Let us keep the feast. We're going to praise God now as we sing our opening hymn, May the Mind of Christ My Savior. God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly bow in your presence this morning as we wait upon you and listen for your word, that you might speak to our hearts. We pray that you would come to us in our worship, but more than that, that you would lift us even into your presence and give us a vision of yourself as you did to your servant Isaiah so long ago, that we might see the King high and lifted up. We pray that you would help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and who now sits at your right hand, making intercession for us. We pray that you would receive our worship, that it would be from our hearts and not only from our lips. You are the great Creator, and we remember that when you had created everything, you pronounced it to be very good. We praise you for your glorious majesty, for your wisdom seen in all your works. But today, as we meet at the Lord's table, we are reminded that the world that you created so well has been spoiled, and the lives that you have given to us are not lived in accordance with your ways. We confess our sin to you today, but we remember that you are also a gracious God, that you love the world so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And so, as we come to you today, we ask that you would remind us of the gospel message, that those who trust in Christ are cleansed and forgiven. And as we meet at the Lord's table and remember his death, we pray that you would give us that assurance. So hear us as we confess our sin. Forgive us not because we are worthy, but because of the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. I want to thank Daphne for her welcome and indeed Elaine for the help that she has given me over the week in preparing for the service. It's lovely to be back in Ballycarry, and I was delighted whenever Mark asked me if I could do this, and particularly being a communion service. I enjoy the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, and I'm looking forward to sharing that later on in the service. I want to talk to the girls and boys. And girls and boys, if you would come up to the front here, I would come down and talk to you for a few minutes before you leave. Well, you all back to school again? You're not back to school yet? They start again tomorrow? Yeah. School's great, isn't it? School is brilliant, isn't it? I thought school was wonderful, but then I used to be a teacher. what's on the table, because this is a little bit different from what we normally have. And there are things underneath here. There's some wine and there's some bread. And later on we're going to be having a special ceremony called communion, or the Lord's Supper. I don't have a very good memory. And sometimes my wife sends me down to the shop to buy three things. A loaf of bread, a pound of butter, and some tomatoes. And guess what? I come home with three things. A loaf of bread, a pound of butter, and a bar of chocolate. And I've forgotten the tomatoes. My head. On the photo, on the screen is a photograph. And that's it. Photograph that helps me to remember way back. Now, that's my mummy holding that baby. And whenever I look at the photograph, that helps me to remember what she looked like, because she's not here anymore. And that's the wee baby she's holding. Isn't he lovely? Say, isn't he lovely? Aww. In the best. And that's a photograph of my daddy. And that's a very special photograph, because he's not here very long. In fact, just after that photograph was taken, he died in hospital because he was very sick at that stage. And that was the last photograph I ever got taken with him. That's my grandpa. And he lived in Belfast, although he was born not very far from here. His name was John Barry. And he grew up and ran away to sea and became a sailor. His daddy wanted him to work and be a delivery man, but he didn't want that. So he went away. It's a long time since he died. But whenever I look at the photograph, I can remember, and that's the very room. I used to play in that room. And that's what my grandma was like. So those photographs help me to remember people in the past who are no longer here. There's another photograph. Those are my grandsons. The problem is I don't see them very often because they live in England. But if I ever wonder, what is it they look like? Well, that's the photograph to remind me. And you know something? They're two rascals. They take it after their granny. They take their hair after me, but they take their... They're great. The one at the front is nearly 8, and the one at the back is nearly 5. In fact, it's his birthday in a few weeks' time. And I love seeing them, but I don't see them very often. But to help me to remember what they're like, I have a photograph. So I have all these photographs to help me remember, because it's so easy to forget. And that's why we have communion. Because whenever Jesus was about to go back to heaven, he wondered, will these guys forget me? Will they forget my sacrifice in dying for them? Will they forget about the cross? What could we do to help them remember? And Jesus devised this special ceremony. And he said this: every time you do this, you remember me. So Jesus wants us to remember him. And all those old people down there, they're very old, some of those people down there, even older than me. And they can't remember things. Some of them forget. But today we're going to remember Jesus. And it's like looking at a photograph. And we remember Jesus dying for us. Because he loves us so much. And you've got to remember Jesus. You have the advantage of being young. And your brains are very active. And you can remember things. You can remember your spellings. You can remember how to add and subtract. And all the things you learned at school, you remember them. And whenever you're as old as I am, you'll still remember some of those things. I can remember spellings I learned at school. I can remember my times tables. I can remember some of the history and geography I learned. But most of all, it's important to remember Jesus. And later on, we're going to remember him. But don't you forget him. Because he loves you so much that he was prepared to die for you so that you could become his friends. Let me pray with you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the girls and boys here in Ballycarry. And we ask that you would bless them, help them as they grow up. And we pray that they would never forget you. Be with them. Bless the homes where they live. And we ask that you would help the teachers here who teach them about your love. Amen. Now we're going to sing, and then you're going to go out. What are we going to sing? We're going to sing, My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty.
Let us hear the word of God. Though your
his people out of Egypt, but later destroyed those who did not believe, and the angels who did not keep their positions of authority, but abandoned their own home. These he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. In a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve as an example of those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire. In the very same way, these dreamers pollute their own bodies, reject authority, and slander celestial beings. But even the archangel Michael, when he was disputing with the devil about the body of Moses, did not dare to bring a slanderous accusation against him, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Yet these men speak abusively against whatever they do not understand. And what things they do understand by instinct, like unreasoning animals, these are the very things that destroy them. Woe to them! They have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. These men are blemishes at your love feasts, eating with you without the slightest qualm, shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds without rain, blown along by the wind, autumn trees without fruit and uprooted. Twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea, foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom blackest darkness has been reserved forever. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. "See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones, to judge everyone and to convict all the ungodly of all the ungodly acts they have done in the ungodly way, and of all the harsh words ungodly sinners have spoken against him." These men are grumblers and fault finders. They follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves and flatter others for their own advantage. Amen. And we know that God will bless this reading from his word. Daphne was mentioning the letter from the moderator, and I would encourage you to take a copy of that. And I think that since he has called for today to be a day of prayer for the Middle East, that we should take a few minutes just to remember all that's happening there. So let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we watch the television screens and we hear the news reports, and we are amazed at the way in which people can treat one another. This is a land that you know well, a land where Jesus walked among people whom he loved. We have no answers except to come to you in prayer and to uphold all those who are working for peace. And we ask that peace would be restored to that region. We believe that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And so we call upon you to intervene he's again there. And we think of the Christian communities, small, sometimes weak, sometimes feeling very much isolated. But we ask that you would remind them of your love and that you would bring peace to their hearts, even in the midst of war. We pray for those who are being held in captivity for so long now that they would be released. We pray for all the people who have been bereaved, regardless of their background, regardless of their religion, regardless of their ethnicity. To lose a loved one, many of us know the anguish and the heartbreak that that brings. And so we pray for those who are mourning today. And while we cannot influence world leaders, peacemakers, we bring our prayers to you. And we ask that you would help us not just to forget about that region, but to continue to pray in our homes and in our church that peace would be restored and honor and glory would be given to you through Jesus. Amen. Remember the 5th of November. Gunpowder, treason and plot. I see no reason why gunpowder and treason should ever be forgot. Tuesday's the 5th of November. Calls to memory the plot by Robert Catesby to blow up the Houses of Parliament and kill King Charles I and many of the leading politicians so that a Catholic monarch could be restored to the throne. That history is largely forgotten today, and throughout certainly England, bonfires will be lit on Friday evening. Fireworks will be let off, but not many people will know why. It's important to remember and to know our past. In Uri, where I was for 31 years, I always associated November with remembering. Because on the first Sunday we had communion, where we remembered the Lord's death. The second Sunday, next week, is Remembrance Day, when we remember those who gave their lives so that we might have freedom. And then down in Uri, on the third Sunday, we had a very special service. I was chaplain, Presbyterian chaplain in Dizzy Hill Hospital. And there was a service organised in the town hall every year on the third Sunday to remember babies and children who had died in the hospital. And that was a very poignant service. There were young couples there who had lost a baby, maybe within the past year, or a child who had died in the hospital. Some of them brought a little candle and placed it at the front. Some of them brought some flowers. But there were older people there as well, remembering children who had died 5, 10, 15 years ago. But what amazed against me was that there were some people who came by themselves. I would have to say, very elderly people. And who sat quietly at the back and always left just as the service was finishing. Perhaps remembering a child who had died 40, 50, 60 years earlier. I conducted the funeral of a man who was just about 60 years of age. His mother lived in one of the little mill houses, quite small, and she always had a roaring fire. And I used to sit as near the door as I could, because if you sat any closer, you would melt. But I remember going in to see Mary shortly after the funeral, and she was sad. And in her sadness, she turned to me and she said, "Mr. Barry, it's hard to lose a child." Well, I was shocked. This man was 60 years of age. He wasn't a child. And of course, to her, he was. And we remember. And it's important to remember. And it's important to remember our own history, who we are, where we're from. As I've said, and as Daphne said, my grandfather was born in Crossmary, Bella Hill. I don't know where. I don't know much about his background. I would love to find out more. We need to understand our Presbyterian background. And of course, where did Presbyterianism in Ireland start? But here in Ballycarry, with Edward Bryce, 1613. We need to remember the past. And in this letter, the people who received the letter are being asked to remember the past and to learn from it. Jude turns to the Old Testament and he wants to bring out some lessons from the stories that we read there. First of all, about Israel itself, God brought the children of Israel out of Egypt. What a wonderful God. But it wasn't very long before they were turning against God. Do you remember there were 12 spies sent into the land? They reconnoitered. They came back. 10 of them gave a bad report. "Oh, there are giants there. We couldn't survive. We couldn't overcome them. We'll have to stay out." But 2 of them had a good report. "The Lord will take us into that land. It's a wonderful land, flowing with milk and honey. The food is wonderful. We've been eating rations for all this time. Let's go in and take that." But the people rebelled. They wouldn't enter the land. And God judged them by making them wander in the desert for 40 years until that generation had died out. And the New Testament takes up that story to emphasize that even people with the greatest privileges are in danger of falling away. Even the most religious people, even those who profess to believe, may be lost because of their sin. What was the sin of the people of Israel? It was unbelief. And then he reminds them about the angels. God created angels to be his messengers. But at some point, some of those angels rebelled and followed Lucifer. He wanted to be like God. His pride took over. But we're told that God banished him and those other sinful angels. We're told in the Old Testament that some of those angels came to earth and tried to take some of the women here to be their wives. In other words, they didn't keep the position that they had been created for. And even the angels, with all their privileges, were judged by God because of their sin. And what was their sin? Their sin was pride. And then there were the towns of Sodom and Gomorrah. They were in the choicest location. The countryside around them was absolutely wonderful. The farmers were in their element. The crops grew almost without any trouble. Whenever Abraham and his family came to the area, Lot chose to live in that area because, and I quote, "the whole plain of the Jordan was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, the Garden of Eden." Wonderful location. But in spite of their privileged location, Sodom and Gomorrah were judged by God because of their sin. Today, that area is a wasteland. And what was their sin? It was immorality. So people with great privileges can ultimately fall if they don't remember their God. Where have they come from? What has God done for them? And ultimately God will judge them. And there were false teachers in Jude's day. And they were trying to lead God's people away in exactly those areas. So Jude says, remember the past. Remember where you've come from. Remember what God has done for you throughout your life. And I'm quite sure that if I were to go around and talk to you today, you could tell me of incidences, of examples, of stories from the past where God has blessed you, where God has picked you up, perhaps out of illness, perhaps through a bereavement, maybe through unemployment, maybe the breakdown of a relationship. There are so many different ways in which God has blessed us. And there might be others who will say, well, you know, I've had no hardship in life. My life has been like living in a beautiful garden. How God has blessed you. We must remember the past. But we must observe the present. See, not only did the false teachers copy the sins of the past, but their lives were clear to those who would look at them. They were like Cain. Now you remember that Cain was the man who committed the first murder. He murdered his brother Abel. So you might say, well, Cain was judged because of his murder. But that wasn't the root of the problem. The root of the problem was that Cain wanted to do religion his way. God had told them to bring a sacrifice from the flock. In other words, an animal had to die. Blood had to be shed. And Abel did that. And God received that. But Cain was different. Cain said, no. I do it my way. I've planted some seeds, so I'll take some grain. And I'll present that as mine. Offering to God. And you see, there are so many people today who are not prepared to accept God's way of salvation. God has said that Jesus is the only mediator between God and man. Jesus said, I am the way to God. There is no other way. But what we find today is that there are many people, even some within our churches, who say, well, I don't really like that way. I prefer my way. I'll do good. I'll come to church every week. I'll say my prayers. I'll help my neighbor. I'll give my money to the poor. And God's going to be pleased with that. But that's the way of Cain. And the false teachers were likewise teaching people that they could earn their salvation rather than depend on Christ. And then there was Balaam. Balaam was a prophet of God, but he was hired by the enemies of God to curse Israel. And he took on the task. Why? Because he was paid a lot of money. And sadly, there were people amongst these false prophets, these false teachers in Jude's day, who were using their gifts to line their own pockets. It didn't matter what they were asked to do. As long as the price was right, they would do it. There was Korah. And Korah and his followers rejected the authority of Moses. And then they dared God to do something about it. In speaking against Moses, Korah was in fact speaking against God. And God judged him for it. And then Jude mentions the character of these false teachers. And it's a warning to us to be on the lookout for those who would try to lead us astray. And I'm not going to go through all of what Jude says, but he describes them as blemishes at your love feast, eating with you without the slightest qualm. Shepherds who feed only themselves. Clouds without rain. What good's a cloud without rain? Blown along by the wind. Autumn trees without fruit and uprooted. No fruit? Uprooted? Twice dead, says Jude. Wild waves of the sea foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom the blackest darkness has been reserved forever. And as we hear Jude describing these false teachers, we see how dangerous they are to God's people. And we need to be on guard against people like that who will maybe call at our door, or who might well appear in our television screens if you watch some of the American stuff. Or maybe through a book that someone gives you, or a magazine, where false teachers will try to take you away. And then finally, we need to prepare for the future. In the examples we've looked at, here were people with great advantages who lost everything because God judged them. It's a trait of false teachers to deny that there will be a future judgment. Some will say, well, you know, everybody will go to heaven. I remember meeting one of the Roman Catholic priests in Uri as I was filling my car, and he came over to chat to me. And he said, I've just been doing a funeral. He said, do you know what Roman Catholics have to do to get into heaven? And I thought, oh no, here's a theological discussion, and I have somewhere else to be. What do Roman Catholics have to do to get into heaven? He looked at me and he said, die. Because they assumed that everybody who died went to heaven. I said, it's not just Roman Catholic. judgment is certain. The Bible clearly teaches that every day, that one day everybody will give an account of their lives to God. Christians and non-Christians. We have Jesus' own description of it, where the goats and the sheep will be separated. So it's important to remember. And we need to remember those warnings from the past. We need to heed them. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, "Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us." These situations affected people. People who had been blessed by God, but who turned their back on Him. And later God judged them. And so Paul continues in that quote, "If you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall." But how can we stand firm? Well, we need to remember Christ. Paul also adds that God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. How can we feeble sinners stand up against all that the evil one can do to us? How can we find our way out of temptation? And those temptations are so strong. How can we resist the subtlety of those false teachers? Well, we remember that Christ has died for us, and that's why we're at the Lord's table today. Let's do in remembrance of me. We remember that His death won remission from our sins, and that once we confess those sins, and once we repent those sins, and once we turn from those sins, we are redeemed. And we remember that the grace that we receive through the sacrament will strengthen us for the week ahead. So as we partake of the bread and wine today, may we be strengthened in our faith by Christ's grace. And may we leave this table remembering that His grace will be sufficient for us no matter what this week holds. This do in remembrance of Him. Amen. We're going to sing, as we come to the Lord's table, this lovely hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Thank you.
The table of our Lord Jesus Christ is open to all who are in communion with the Church of Jesus Christ. We therefore invite all who are in such communion, who love the Lord Jesus in sincerity and in truth, to examine themselves and to join this holy fellowship. Hear the gracious words of the Lord Jesus. Come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. As we come to the Lord's table, let us stand and confess our faith as we say the words of the Apostles' Creed, which has been used by Christians for 1,500 years. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Beloved in the Lord, as we come to the Lord's table, hear the words of institution of the sacrament as spoken by our Lord and given to the Apostle Paul. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man and a woman ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread or drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. As the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread and wine, I take these elements to be set apart by prayer from all common uses to this holy use and mystery for which he has appointed them. And as he gave thanks, let us do likewise. Let us pray. O God, by the blood of your Son, you have provided a new and living way into your presence. Assure us now of your mercy as we meet at this feast. We praise and bless you that when we rebelled against you, you did not leave us to die in our sin, but sent your Son to be an atoning sacrifice. As we gather at this table today, we thank you for his death on the cross, that his body was broken and his blood shed, thus winning remission for the sins of his people. As we celebrate the feast of our redemption, we proclaim the death of Jesus and announce his resurrection and ascension until he comes in glory. Be pleased to sanctify these elements of bread and wine, and so bless this sacrament that that through faith they may become to us the body and blood of your most dear Son, and through the power of the Holy Spirit we may become his living body, our souls preserved blameless till he comes again. Through him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests unto God, even Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. According to the institution, example, and command of our blessed Saviour, Jesus Christ, and as a memorial to him, we do this. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink it, drink in remembrance of me." When you receive your bread, please hold it and we'll all communicate together. This cup is the new covenant in the blood of Christ, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink all of it.